Our first scripture lesson comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 58, verses 6 through 10. Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them, and not hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindication shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, Here I am. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. Our second scripture lesson comes from the book of James, chapter 2, verses 14 through 17. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, Go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So by faith itself, if it has no works, is dead. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Be seated. Will you bow with me in prayer? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer, and let all God's people say, Amen. Amen. So with this message on works of mercy, this worship series called The Six Means of Grace comes to an end. Just to review, means of grace is a phrase that John Wesley and others used ages ago to refer to those regular, those daily, weekly spiritual practices that put us in connection with God's love. They're habits that we can develop, which become channels for God's grace to flow into our lives. And John Wesley divided the works of grace, means of grace, into two broad categories. On the one hand, there were works of piety, and we've already covered the five of those. There's prayer and fasting and searching the scriptures and Christian conferencing or small group ministry and the Lord's Supper. And today we pick up the works of mercy. And in John Wesley's old-fashioned language, let me read to you what he said the works of mercy was. He said that it is everything which we give or speak or do, whereby another man may receive any advantage, either in body or soul, the feeding the hungry, the clothing the naked, the entertaining or assisting the stranger, the visiting those that are sick or in prison, the comforting the afflicted, the instructing the ignorant, the reproving the wicked, the exhorting or encouraging the well-doer. And among the works of mercy, John Wesley also included advocating for justice, as in his own political activity to end the slave trade in Great Britain in the 1700s. So after all of that, you might wonder, well, you know, which is more important, the works of piety or the works of mercy? And the only way I have to respond to that is, well, both. Both are critical and vital to the Christian life. You know that Jesus gave one great commandment, right? But it had two parts. It was love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and it's love your neighbor as you love yourself. And so the works of piety, prayer and fasting and searching the scriptures, these are ways that help us to love God better. And the works of mercy, visiting the sick and visiting those in prison and feeding the hungry, these are ways that we learn to love God better, or we learn to love our neighbor better. So they're both necessary for the Christian life. However, if forced to lean one direction or the other, if John Wesley had been forced to choose either works of piety or works of mercy, he says, well, works of mercy, because they're not only means of grace, they are actual acts of love. And he says, after all, that's the whole purpose of our religion. And we just heard from the book of James that if all we do is sit around in our room and read the Bible and pray, what good is that to people who are hungry and starving to death? It isn't any good. So both are important. John Wesley leaned towards works of mercy. So we're talking today about these works of mercy. I think that in the church today, the language that we most often use is service, right? Service to others, ways that we use our energy, our time, our spiritual gifts to assist and be with people in need. Sometimes it gets called outreach ministry. Sometimes we call it mission. Whatever you call it, the works of mercy, now you begin to see how all of these means of grace work together, right? How they interact with each other to support the Christian life. For example, we can't just pray for hungry people, right? We also have to actually feed hungry people. But at the same time, we don't just feed hungry people. We also pray for their lives to change. We pray for society to change so that everybody will have enough. Or think about it this way. When we search the scriptures, we find God's imperative to us, or God's command to us, to do justice. And as we do justice, we bring new eyes back when we read the scriptures, right? Or think about it this way. In his class meetings, his small groups, John Wesley required that group leaders ask these three questions every single meeting. Have you set aside anything for the needy? Have you done anything to help the poor? And have you visited the sick? Ask those questions every single time. So you see, the purpose of small group ministry is to support and encourage us in our works of mercy. All of these means of grace have to work together to build the Christian life. Now, just a little bit later, I'm going to share with you some key important ways that you can start serving right away through this church. I know many of you already do, but if you haven't, I'll share with you some of those ways. I'll ask you to find a way or two that fits your schedule and your own spiritual gifts and to get started. But before I get there, I want to just explore with you a little bit about how it is that serving others is actually good for our own spiritual life, right? About how reaching out and serving the poor is actually a means by which God's grace floods into our own life. And I start by acknowledging that since I've read your connection cards, what you wrote about service last Sunday, I'm aware that many of you do not need this sermon. I hope that you'll listen to it, but I'm aware that you really don't need it. You could preach this sermon. You already know how it is that serving others is good for your own soul. Just out of curiosity, I asked you last Sunday to write down, what's your favorite way of serving? And there were lots and lots of responses that occurred only once, such as visiting shut-ins. I wish that occurred more than once. Mowing the church lawn, crocheting things and giving them away, serving my husband who is in a nursing home, helping people with their taxes. I saved that name for next March, by the way. Teaching Sunday school, and on it goes. And then I asked, and there were some responses that occurred over and over, lots of cards. So people said using music to bring joy to others. A lot of people said anything to do with children. Jane Habitat for Humanity showed up several times. I'll feed you some names, okay? Mission trips and food. The number one answer was food, whether that's for interfaith hospitality or community dinner or funeral meals or what have you. Food was your number one way, favorite way to serve others. Here are the ways, though, that you shared that you are aware that serving other people actually builds up our own faith. Quite a few people noted that serving others kind of removes the focus from ourself and our own life. You know how sometimes we just get to stewing in our own juices, and serving other people kind of gets us out of ourself. It's a means of grace. Second, a lot of people said that serving ties us directly to Matthew 25, and the least of these are brothers and sisters. I'm going to talk about that a little more in a few moments. Quite a few people talked about perspective. They said, serving others puts my own needs and worries in a different perspective. And that's true, isn't it? Sometimes we get to thinking, oh, woe is me, you know, my troubles are so big. Try visiting somebody in prison. Huh? Try going to a nursing home. And all of a sudden, you just see things in a different way. And finally, more than anything else, people said that serving others keeps me connected to God, because I know I'm doing what God wants. I'm sharing God's love in the world. All great answers. And here are my top four answers. Having read all of your connection cards, having searched the scriptures again, having read through John Wesley, here are my top four ways that serving others is good for our own spiritual life, how it's a means for God's grace to come flooding into our own life. First of all, serving others aligns us with God's will, both God's will for the world and God's will for our own lives. Here's what I mean. We know, right? I mean, we truly know that it is God's will for everybody to have enough to eat, and for everybody to have a safe place to live. So, when we feed the hungry, when we house the homeless, we know that we are aligned with God's will. Again, we know, beyond the shadow of a doubt, we know that God doesn't want anybody to be isolated and lonely, right? And so when we visit the sick, when we visit people in prison, we are aligned with God's will for the world. But serving others also aligns us with God's will for our own lives. Why is that? Well, because we were made to serve others, right? We were created by God to care for other children of God. God has given to each and every one of us spiritual gifts. And we live the abundant life not by hoarding those spiritual gifts for ourselves, but by giving them away, by giving ourselves away. And so we naturally feel more alive. We naturally feel more connected to God when we're doing what God made us to do, which is serving other people. So works of mercy are a means of grace because they keep us aligned with God's will. That's one. Ready for number two? Ready for number two? Okay, I just want to make sure that it's not nap time out there. Number two, here's how John Wesley put it. He said that engaging in works of mercy increases our sensitivity to human need and deepens our capacity to love. Isn't that a marvelous phrase? Works of mercy, it increases our sensitivity to human need, and it deepens our capacity to love. In other words, caring for the sick, or visiting people in prison, or feeding the hungry, these things make us better people, my friends. They make us more like Christ. It also means that certain ways of serving others are kind of more a means of grace than others. And what I mean is that it is relationships that matter the most. Not just the preparing of the food, that's good, but it's the relationships that matter the most. And Wesley wrote, so one reason why the rich in general have so little sympathy for the poor is that they so seldom visit them, right? It's the relationships that are transformative. So getting to know some people who are very different from you, maybe a different culture, different socioeconomic background, different belief system, getting to know somebody very different from you, what their struggles are, what life feels like for them, what their hopes and dreams are, this is what, again in Wesley's words, increases our sensitivity to human need, and it's what increases our capacity to love. That sounds like grace to me. Doesn't it sound like grace to you? In other words, when you really get to know somebody who's different from you, all of a sudden, it's harder to criticize and judge them, isn't it? And it's a whole lot easier to love them. Serving is a means of grace, not just for the people we're serving, but for our own life and our own heart. That's number two, okay? Ready for number three? There we go. You're right with me. Isaiah 58 has the people of Israel kind of wondering, God, we're doing all this stuff for you, and why aren't you doing anything for us? Specifically, they say, God, why do we fast and you don't pay attention? Why do we humble ourselves and you don't even seem to see? And God says, you want to know why I'm not paying attention to what you're doing? Well, it's because you're not doing the right stuff. God says, the fast that I want is for you to address injustice. God says, the worship that I'm looking for is for you to give your bread to the hungry and bring homeless people into your own houses. God says, the praise that I want is for you to make sure everybody has a warm coat and that your own family doesn't end up in poverty. You see, sometimes in the church, I doubt that it's ever happened in this church, but in some churches I've heard that there's still kind of disputes and arguments about what honors God the most. Should we sing traditional hymns or should we sing new praise? You've never had this discussion, I know. Some people say we should use prepared liturgy. No, we should have spontaneous worship. And we argue about those things. And in Isaiah 58, it's pretty clear that God says, I don't really care about any of that. Are you visiting the sick? Are you caring for the poor? Are you doing justice? That's what I'm looking for, God says. So, serving others is a means of grace, because it's the truest form of worship. Huh? It's what warms God's heart. It's what puts a smile on God's face. It is a means of grace. Read Isaiah 58. Finally, very briefly, in your connection cards, quite a number of you, five or six of you, referred directly to Matthew 25 and that parable of the sheep and the goats. Just to summarize, at the last judgment, it says the Son of Man is going to divide all of us into two groups, right? The sheep on the one hand, the goats on the other hand, and the only criteria for judgment will be whether or not in this life we have fed the hungry, given a drink to the thirsty, clothed the naked, visited those in prison, cared for the sick, and welcomed strangers. That's the criteria of the last judgment. And it turns out that both sets of people, both the sheep and the goats, are surprised, right? Both of them say, but Jesus, when did we ever see you that you were hungry or thirsty or naked? When did we ever see you when you were a stranger or in prison or sick? And remember what Jesus says, truly I tell you, when you did it for one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you did it to me. Now I want you to think carefully about that story. When we, who we hope have enough or something like enough, when we serve those who are in need, according to this story, we are not Jesus to them, right? They are Jesus to us. That's what the story says. So serving others is a means of grace, because it's how we meet Jesus. It is how we come into contact with Jesus himself. That's a means of grace, isn't it? So, I understand that there are countless ways to serve out there. A lot of them don't have anything to do with this church or any church. I say, go for it. I would love to hear all of the different ways you serve all over the community, all around the world. But I want to share with you right now a handful of ways that you can get started serving right now, right here at Bethel International Church. I want to apologize ahead of time. I'm still brand new here, you know. If I've left off your favorite project, please forgive me. Just come and tell me. I'll put it on the list and I'll start sharing it other times. John Henderson has created two whole tables of information about ways to serve here at Bethel Church. And on your connection card, all of the ones that I'm going to talk about here in a minute are on the connection card, and you can just check the ones that you're interested in, and pretty soon somebody will reach out to you and help you to get involved. So, Scott, you ready? Here they are. First of all, the Barnabas Ministry. The Barnabas Ministry, are they there? They're looking for him. Hello. Are you going to get him? All right, pay no attention to the screens. Listen to the preacher. And they're listed on your connection card. You can follow along. The Barnabas Ministry is a ministry that provides personal attention to our church members who are homebound or are in nursing homes, critical ministry. And here's what I want to say about that. This is a perfect service project for whole families, including children and grandchildren, because children are the hit of the day at a nursing home. You know that, right? And children need to develop relationship with seniors. So think about doing this Barnabas Ministry with your whole family. There they are on the screen. Second, the mission trip to Belize, which many of you have been a part of, provides some material support, lots of spiritual encouragement to our brothers and sisters in Central America. The next time we go is in February, and I plan to be there. My first trip to Belize coming up early next year. Our preschool can use volunteers to read to kids and to play with kids and just to be with children. Once you've been a part of the church for 6 months, you can be part of our Sunday morning children's ministry in Sunday school or in children's worship at 11 o'clock. You all know that serving with children is really special. It blesses our hearts. The community dinner, I've got to be a part of it two or three times. It is fantastic. It serves nutritious, delicious food on real plates with real silverware, with real fellowship around tables. It's the last Thursday of every month. It takes a whole army to pull it off, and you can be a part of that army, all right? Funeral meals. I cannot tell you as a pastor how important it is for a bereaved family after the funeral to be able to sit down and be served with the meal. You can just relax. You can continue the conversation. So maybe you can provide food. Maybe you can help serve at that ministry at a critical time in people's life. For the last 2 years, this is outside of the church, for the last 2 years, I have been a graduation mentor. Columbus City Schools partners every senior who is at risk of graduating in any school with an outside mentor. No teaching, no academic work, no tutoring at all. It's about life skills. So time management, how to cope with stress at home. Both of the students that I have mentored have graduated, huh? I can hook you up with that. They don't need too many at Centennial, but other schools need them. I would strongly encourage you to think about that ministry. You'll hear a little bit later today more about Habitat for Humanity. What I want to add to that is that a couple of times a year we have church-wide work days, but you don't have to wait for those. All throughout the year, you can go with your hammer by yourself. You can go with a small group of people. You don't have to wait for us to ask. You can just tell Jane that you want to go, and we'll find a way for you to go. You can provide food, since you say you love food, huh? You can provide food for Interfaith Hospitality Network. It goes to the family homeless shelter. You can also help to take it, and you get to play with the kids and interact with the families. It is a real blessing. Or you can spend time one-on-one with some of our Korean college students as English conversation partners. Not only do you help them learn English, you develop a lifelong relationship. Every year, Our Korean students take a mission trip of their own. I believe they're going to Mexico again. So maybe you don't know Korean, but maybe you know Spanish, and you can help them on that trip. What a wonderful thing that would be. Carrie and John, every year, try to partner church members with those young people who are going off to college to support their faith, to keep that connection to the church strong. Frankly, as the father of a college student, I know how important that is. I hope that you'll consider being a part of that ministry. Sparrow House is a ministry that collects clothing and Christmas gifts and household items for needy families in rural southern Ohio. Please bring your items only at the designated time so they don't fill up the whole church, but do bring them. And sometimes we need people to help drive the stuff down to southern Ohio. As you heard John say, every Sunday you can be part of a card signing ministry, and we send cards to two or three church members who are going through a hard time. And if you've ever lost a loved one, if you've ever had surgery or had a health crisis, you know how important it is to hear from your church family. You can be a part of that. I have not seen the Upward Basketball Ministry in action yet, but I'm looking forward to it. And in the new year, we'll need volunteer coaches and greeters and scorekeepers and what have you. Again, it takes a whole crowd of people to do it, but it's a way to meet young families who live right here in our community. I hope that you'll want to be a part of it. And of course, our youth go on a mission trip every year. Maybe you're a youth who would like to go, but of course they need adult supervision and support of all different kinds. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to prayerfully hold that connection card in your hand and decide which of those you're going to check that you want to be a part of. And here's why. Because serving others is not only for the people that you serve, it's also for your own spiritual growth. In other words, works of mercy, serving others, is a means by which God's grace will come flooding into your own life. And with that, we conclude the means of grace. Remember, they all work together to support a holistic, a healthy Christian life. May it be so for you.